Welcome to the Archaeology and Metal Detecting Magazine Weekly Newscast.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Dave Sadler with the Archaeology and Metal Detecting Magazine Weekly Newscast. We've got an announcement. The Detective Days itself will be Saturday the 6th and Sunday the 7th of April. And the usual September event will be announced in the coming weeks as well. Support and sponsor from this event obviously is from late information as I've mentioned earlier. And for many of the main businesses in the world of metal detecting, they aim to bring you the ultimate spring metal detecting value for the most memorable metal detecting events. So on the website, if you go to detectable.com, you will be able to book your tickets via the dedicated online ticket system, check an event updates and information on sponsors, see what prizes are available, discover more about the area and history, and look for local hotels and the campsites, etc. So please check on the detectable.com website, and you'll be able to find all the information that you need to find to be able to participate in the spring detectable. He was a British naval officer who in 1803 led his first expedition to circumnavigate Australia and his vibe of Protestant within the continental town. He died in 1814 and was buried in a London cemetery at the graveyard subsequently, obviously black, and was later redeveloped into a car park. Oh, it's a car park again. I've reported he's not in Britain. We've had a number of car park archaeological a bit of a laughing thing in the UK at the moment, how many burials being found underneath the car park. Anyway, the headstones were themselves noticed before the way, and the location identities of the graves, and 60,000 of them were lost and forgotten. A portion of the old burial ground became a site of Euston railway station, and a popular urban myth sprang up that Cimbers was buried underneath platform 16. Now, how do we know it was Cimbers? Among the thousands of marked graves, obviously, it's a long shot. His coffin was actually one of the few bearing a lead plaque inscribed with the occupant's name. So it's a quite exciting finding in UK and Australian archaeology. That's the first story this week of the remains of Captain Matthew Cimbers being found on the Euston Station. Amateur archaeologist Steve Tomlinson, who is becoming on the archaeology and the All Metal Made Useful podcast with us in a week to discuss what he does with his model archaeology and also this historical find. He initially thought it was a piece of rubbish, but when he had it analysed after his fellow beach called Comers, like Cullen Mudlarkers, I think this might be an American-ism type site that I'm looking at the moment, told him it could be historic. He's in talks with different museums for the on display, and it's believed to be 1,000 years old from around the time of the Norman Conquest. He says it's a quite rare find, amazingly, it's superbly preserved. Probably due to the fact it was well preserved in clay along with the stage, keeping it constantly waterlogged. As I say, there's lots and lots of images of this shoe. Originally thought it was a piece of glass, but now a 95.4% probability that the shoe is from around 1017 to 1059 AD, which is also the time of the Vikings. And hopefully that will be going on show in a museum in the UK very, very soon. Fantastic find. Well done to him. Next in the news, Egypt has been very popular in our reports over the past few months. And again, we pop over to the Valley of the Kings. A decade-long restoration of Tutankhamun's tomb finally concludes. Conservators stabilised stained crypt wall paintings, introduced viewing platforms and barriers designed to limit visitor access to fragile areas. I've very lucky in my travels in my life to have visited the Valley of the Kings and paid the extra entrance fee to enter Tutankhamun's tomb, and it was in comparison to some of the other tombs that you were able to go in, obviously this one being probably the most famous and probably the most well known. Some of the other tombs actually put this to shame. It's only a small, I think it's two-room crypt, if I remember correctly. You can obviously comment on that otherwise, but I think it was nearly 100 years since archaeologist Howard Carter chanced upon wonderful things hidden within King Tutankhamun's tomb. Boards of researchers and tourists have ventured inside the world's most famous Egyptian crypt, unwittingly introducing unwanted hitchhikers such as dust, humidity and carbon dioxide, which have been expecting. All of the artwork, all of the paint, all of the whole of the crypt, actually. So now conservators have put a 10-year project on and completed it, and I think it's now available for people to obviously visit again. and taking the glory and the splendour of the world's most famous film. Luckily, Megan Gammon, who taught the life science, a newly concluded restoration project spearheaded by the Los Angeles-based Getty Conservation Institute and the Egyptian Ministry of Antiquities, and stabilised the ancient tomb, countering damage inflicted by the masses and ensuring the heritage site will remain accessible for generations to come. According to their press release, conservators stabilised wall paintings, which have been marred by scratchings and abrasions, as well as a layer of dust transferred from visitors' shoes and clothing. The team also created viewing platforms and barriers designed to maintain visibility, which simultaneously keeping visitors a safe distance away from more sensitive sections of the tomb. They've installed an air filtration and ventilation system to mitigate the effects of humidity, carbon dioxide and dust, and instituted an array of related visitor management measures. Now, there's a YouTube video available for people to pop onto, Saving Tutankhamun's Tomb, which I believe will tell you all in Sunday about what transpired and what they've done and what they will be doing in the future to keep it as it is now. And obviously these conservation projects are very difficult for them to do, and do save all of this beautiful artwork and beautiful history for generations and generations to come. So again, pop along onto the internet and Google the decade-long restoration of Tutankhamun's Tomb, and you will be able to see these images in all their glory, and as well as jumping onto YouTube and looking for Saving Tutankhamun's Tomb, and you'll be able to visually see and hear exactly what transpired in Egypt. Finally this week, we have a metal detecting story, how two metal detectors discovered a complete Roman treasure. Back in 2017, in Ordinary Field, two brothers from Brabant discovered more than 100 ancient coins. A leading historian who examined the coins concluded that they constituted a genuine Roman treasure. And the images on this particular site, this is based off the organ looking at, show the chaps metal detecting, show them digging up bits and bottoms. And images of some of the coins separately as well. Now, obviously, metal detecting has grown exponentially in the past couple of years in the UK. The boom from the 70s and 80s, which died down, and again took off. And to be fair, I honestly would suggest that it's now bigger than ever. The amount of people involved in metal detecting is looking to discuss some of the work that the National Council of Metal Detecting do in the background regarding metal detecting and how they assist ourselves in the UK with our work and the legalities that take place to assist us, to keep us being able to do what we do, the insurance that they cover us with, which one thing of importance I did want to mention was that during the show that we discussed on All Metal Mode UK a couple of weeks ago with John Wells, we originally thought that membership and insurance was unavailable to people from outside the UK. Now, I have been told otherwise, and obviously I can get that to yourself, know those of us who know. That isn't the case. You can actually become a member of the National Council for Metal Detecting if you live outside of the UK, America, and France, etc, etc. Now, the only things that do apply is that this covers you only when metal detecting in the UK. It doesn't cover you when metal detecting, obviously, in your own country. So if you are a visitor coming to the UK and you would like to look into having some insurance, having the backing of the National Council for Metal Detecting while on British soil, please visit www.ncmd.co.uk and click on the English, the Union Jack flag, sorry, the Union flag, because we're not at sea, and click on there, fill it in, and obviously communicate from outside of the UK and etc. All will be sorted for you. Anyway, back to Brabant. I'm going to be late. Nico van Schlack sounded like he was in a rush when he told his wife in February 2017. There was an edge to his voice. Don't expect me home for dinner. It's crazy here. Then hung up. His wife didn't have a clue what was going on. The afternoon had actually been rather unsuccessful up to that point. Nico and his brother Wim had been tramping through fields in Burlicum, a village in Brabant, not far from Den Bosch, for a good few hours swinging their metal detectors to and fro. Long sweeps over the ground with its light dusting of snow, left, right, left, right. The cold gradually began to bite, and their gloves and the metal detector were growing heavier by the minute. It would be dark soon. Over in Holland. Oh! The metal detector in Holland. That would be one of my favourite places to detect other than France and probably Belgium, I think. I'd love to, Italy, of course. Imagine the Roman finds over there. Of course, you always find something during a day's detector, an old pink out here, a pot there, or one of the countless yards from wartime grenades and bombs that still litter the ground in Holland. But these bits and pieces are not why the brothers do it. If only because the boot of their car is always full of that stuff. That day, as Wim would later recall, all they found was rubbish. They could only see one silver lining. At least they hadn't found any unexploded grenades. If they had, they would call the bomb disposal expert to blow them up and carry on detecting. Anyway, Nico's metal detector went ping. Next thing, up came the Roman coins. Historian Lisbeth Clays of Leiden University. Although she browses internet forums very regularly, she has never seen anything like this. Two brothers claiming to have large quantities of Roman coins. And they were checked, and they were, all the work was done on these 103 coins, showing four silver denarii, bronze sesterce, and asses. And they were obviously taken away to the archaeologists, and they were found to be minted between the reigns of Empress Vespasianus and Marcus Aurelius. The find also contains one older coin by mint master Calpurnius. So, yes, again, have a look onto the internet and look for the two brothers who discovered a complete Roman treasure in Holland. I got a bit of a foot phone at the start of that, man. Two brothers from Brabant. I actually thought it was Welsh. There you go. So, that's our story for the week. Again, if you want any information on the Spring Detector Book, pop on to detectorbook.com or even to LP, Metal Detecting, Laser Promotions, or if you want any information on the National Council for Metal Detectors at ncmd.co.uk. Our own website, which will be informed of at the end in our going out music, is www.archmbmag.com or .co.uk I think as well, because we've got both end domains. And finally, All Metal Mode UK takes place on a Thursday night in the UK from 8 p.m. And that's at on Spreaker. If you go onto Spreaker.com, not Spreaker, Spreaker with an R, and search for All Metal Mode UK. Now, this coming week, we have Jason Massey from Detecting for Veterans. He'll be discussing the work that his Facebook group does to get people who have the likes of PTSD and other things associated with being in the armed forces to have found that metal detecting does help them a lot. The following week, we will have Tony Kaywood discussing the Rootus and the updates to the Rootus kit. The following week, February the 14th, Valentine's Day, so I'll probably get into Columbus or doing it like that, and not doing anything Valentine-y, is Gary Fenn from Heavy Metal Detecting. The following week, as mentioned previously, is a mudlarking show with Steve Tomlinson. On Thursday the 28th of February, Addicted to Bleach from YouTube and Friends. March the 7th is Nathan and Matt from Black Ada, or Ada, which we will find out off the mouth and pay out correctly. Currently on the 14th of March, we're hoping to have Mark Ollie from TV show on ITV in the UK, Lost Treasures. He's an archaeologist who I was lucky to actually be able to participate in on archaeology on Mark's sites in the early 2000s. It really gave me my break in the archaeological field, which I'll be forever grateful for. On March the 21st, we have Matt from Seascope. And finally, for now, March the 28th, we have archaeologist Alison Smith taking part in the show. So that's us for this week, and I hope you enjoyed it. If not, give me a shout to editor@archmdmag.com and tell me why. Thanks, everyone.
The Archaeology and Metal Detecting magazine acts as a hub for information, offering articles from archaeologists, detectorists and other specialists throughout the genre. Featuring many links, event info and news articles associated to archaeology and metal detecting. We also offer professional review services and promotion for books, resources, videos, documentaries, gadgets, equipment and much, much more. The magazine is run by the Archaeological and Metal Detecting Community for the Archaeological and Metal Detecting Community. So come visit us at archmdmag.com. That's archmdmag.com. And check out information from our media section with all the latest content, news from the Archaeology Channel, podcasts and the YouTube channels that feature the now legendary Digger Dawn, The Man with the Hat and Archaeo Duck, just to name a few. If you would like to offer an article, link or inquire about other services, then pay us a visit at archmdmag.com and drop us a line.